Good morning and welcome to our service, whether you're here as a regular attender or as a visitor or watching online. The following are the announcements to add to or to reinforce those on your orders of service. The property committee will meet after the service in the minister's room, whilst at the same time the communications committee will meet in the session room. The walking group meets here on Tuesday morning at 10 a.m. to head to Carrickfergus, and as usual everyone is welcome to join in. PW meet on Tuesday the 30th of January at 7:45 for a transformation challenge with Belle East and Sewing Bee Helen Duff. All ladies are invited to attend. Congregation committee meets on Wednesday at 8 o'clock with the business committee at 7:30. On Thursday week between 7 and 9, we're hosting in the Brand Memorial Hall a workshop on recognising and dealing with stress and anxiety in young people, an ever-increasing problem. This workshop is for youth leaders, community workers, parents, church leaders, indeed anyone who works with young people across the local area. It's being run by Eden Consultancy and is funded by the Presbyterian Children's Society as part of their Young Minds Matter project. Finally, you're asked to remember in your prayers the family and friends of Ewell McRae, our neighbour in the village, elder in First Valley Easton, and for 25 years headmaster of the local secondary school. Mr. McRae died last Monday morning.
For great are the works of the Lord, contemplated upon by all who delight in them. And so we come to learn, to listen, and to rejoice in the good news of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Let us worship God.
A reading from the Gospel according to Mark. Jesus drives out an impure spirit. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an impure spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." The impure spirit shook the man violently, and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching, and with authority? He even gives orders to impure spirits, and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. God of flaming truth and burning compassion, give to your people the courage to turn to you with awe, yet without fear. You are so great, we are so small. You are so holy, we feel so tarnished. You are beauty itself, and we may feel shabby. You are sublimely loving. We are creatures of self-interest. As we turn to you, turn to us, we pray. And in the light of your presence, let us find our true love and worship. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And hear us as he taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Girls and boys, do you want to come and join me if you're upstairs? The ever-growing mob up there, you want to come and join me downstairs? Hi there. You want to sit down? How's everybody?
Good.
You good? You're always usually good at answering questions. Are you awake today? No? Sleepy heads? Not sleepy. All right. Maybe this isn't an easy question, but I think you're up to it. What is a wise person? What do you think?
Oh.
Someone who's smart? Okay. Jesus, yes.
Someone who makes the right decisions.
That's an interesting answer as well. Someone who makes the right decisions. Those are all good answers. Wise people, actually, that's a good introduction. Make the right decision instead of the wrong decision. Maybe another way. Do you know any wise people? Who might be wise?
Dumbledore.
Well, he makes all the right decisions, doesn't he, in the books? Do you know anybody in real life you might think is wise? You?
God.
God, yes. Any people you know who are wise? Who do you think?
My dad.
Your dad? There's a vote of your mum doesn't think so. Actually, mums and dads do make a lot of wise decisions, don't they? About, as you said, making the right decision. You know, I've known lots of wise people through the years, and I'm really, really thankful for them because they've taught me lots. Because you know what? Wise people keep us safe and happy. So just like mums and dads, or maybe even grandparents, or aunts and uncles and others in our families, or maybe even good friends can be wise at times because they know what the right thing to do is to keep us safe. And growing up, I've had lots of people teach me wise things. You know, a clever person would tell you all about cars and what makes them run and how the engine works. But a wise person will say, always look both ways when you're crossing the road. Do you know that one? Do you all do it? Good. That's a wise thing to do. Because it's okay to know about cars, but you've got to look out for them. So a wise thing to do is to make the right decision and always look left or right before you go anywhere. And yes, you were quite right. We say that Jesus is a wise person because we believe in church that Jesus was the wisest person ever. And he came today when Ruth was reading our Bible story. He came to a town and he was teaching everybody about all the things that were good and right. And people were amazed at Jesus. And we believe that when we come to church, that we need to learn from Jesus so that we can be happy and safe. And we do that by listening to the Bible stories, and we do that by listening to those who are older than us and who may have lots of experience and are wiser than us, and we do it together. We learn from each other, but most of all, we listen to Jesus. That's what I'm going to be talking about to the grown-ups later in the sermon. But we're all thinking today about listening to Jesus because of his wisdom and how he can help us be happy and safe and always know to do the right thing. So let's have a prayer for you. Let's pray. Dear God, there's lots of stuff we can learn, but most of all, help us to be wise and know how to use all that knowledge in our heads to do the right thing, that we may be safe and happy and always to help others, which can be one of the wisest things ever. And we pray for this in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, Amen. Thank you. Should we all stand? Then everybody stand up. We're going to sing. Connor, what are we going to sing?
I'm Special.
There we go. All right. You're thanks for all your wise answers. Have fun in Sunday Club. We'll see you later. A prayer of confession. Let us pray. Jesus, you sought out the still places. In these moments set aside for worship, we come to you, not with too many words, that we may find refreshment and nourishment for our souls. Still our souls, quieten our anxious thoughts as we gather in your presence and refocus our lives on you. O God, our merciful Redeemer, we who have sinned in word, thought, and deed, and in what we have left undone, humbly ask you to meet us where we need to be forgiven and set our feet again upon the path that leads to life. Loving God, may we, with a broken world, know your touch of healing and restoration as we thank you for sisters and brothers across the world and every act of human kindness. Set free to worship you with our whole hearts, we sing and tell of the joy there is in you, God of new beginnings, who leads us through the dark valleys to green pastures, who offers us a foretaste of the new creation. May all glory and honor be yours, faithful God of mercy, justice, and love. Amen.
Of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. In Him no sin is found. We stand.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet, like me, from among you, from your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him. For this is what you asked the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let us not hear the voice of the Lord our God, nor see this great fire any more, or we will die." The Lord said to me, "What they say is good. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their fellow Israelites, and I will put my words in his mouth. He will tell them everything I command him. I myself will call to account anyone who does not listen to my words the prophet speaks in my name. But a prophet who presumes to speak in my name anything I have not commanded, or a prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, is to be put to death. Thanks be to God."
Frosty wind may blow.
So, were you a fan, or did you avoid it? The last episode of the latest series of The Traitors aired on the BBC this week. A whodunit murder mystery that's a mix of Cluedo and Wink murder. I confess, I would quite like to have been a traitor. But one of my other colleagues said to me they hated the show because they thought everybody on it was too stupid and it just annoyed them too much. But loved or loathed, it made the headlines. And the basic premise is that the players in this reality show have to work out who can be trusted. Is someone faithful or a traitor? And it's amazing to see how bad people can be at working out who they can trust. And to be fair to them, it's not easy. You also are useless at it. We all are. In psychology, we talk about biases all the time. One of the most well-known ones might be confirmation bias, that instead of actually looking at the facts, you only look at the things that you think are right to support what you believe. So if you think somebody is a bad person, you look for any evidence that might say they're a bad person and completely ignore all the information that actually says they're okay. That's confirmation bias. And we all do it all the time. Or maybe the one you do all the time, like all of us, is maybe when somebody you meet for the first time, you look at their clothes, or their stud in their nose, or the color of their hair, or their accent, and you jump to conclusions about that person. It's not easy to know about other people sometimes, simply because of the way our own brains work. It's equally not easy to know who to trust in the world that we live in. For the amount of misinformation and bad players across the political spectrum or online or in print or on the radio makes it difficult for all of us to work out who is helpful or harmful in real life. And if you're a parent and you see your children starting to get into YouTube or other things like Instagram, and the content that they can be watching, is it helpful or harmful to them? One of the good things, by the way, is kids are usually way ahead of you. They know better. You might need to ask them. TV shows are for entertainment. But the reality of misinformation in our world is deadly. And a medical friend asked me this week, what's your sermon on Sunday? They never go near a church, but they were interested. And I said, well, the story of Jesus coming in, and we're told that he's speaking with authority and all the rest of it, and issues about misinformation. And they said, oh, that's easy, measles. First thing that came to their mind, I said, thanks, that's in the sermon. Those who claim to be an authority on health, for example, by promoting misinformation and conspiracy theories about vaccines, playing on the very real fears of parents, for example, have caused a dreadful increase in measles across the UK and Europe. Just a few years ago, the World Health Organization declared eradicated, and now it's back with horrific consequences for children. And when it comes to war, Israel, Gaza, Ukraine with Russia, how often does the cliche that truth is the first victim come true? Misinformation and falsehood harms. It undermines and destroys. False authorities kill. It's nothing new in one sense. Kimberly, who read that passage from Deuteronomy, shows the struggle ancient faith communities had to say, well, who actually can speak for God? When somebody rocks up and says, I'm a prophet, this is the way you should do things, why do they have authority to listen to them? It was a serious offense to give misinformation, to be a false prophet. But who do we listen to? Who is an actual authority on the way the world works? Our gospel story today is a story of authority. Jesus comes to the synagogue and begins to teach, amazing those present with his authority. Suddenly, a man screams out,
described as being possessed by an unclean spirit, interrupting those listening. This is not an ancient story about mental health. Those categories do not apply here and would have made no sense to the audience listening that day. Mark, the writer of the Gospel, wants us to know that when good news is proclaimed, there will be opposition. This comes right at the start of Mark's Gospel, and it follows on from Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, which Jesus overcomes. And here, the man with the unclean spirit stands as yet another example of demonic opposition to God's kingdom. He is someone trapped by evil, yet once again, the authority of Jesus cannot be defeated. Satan's power has been broken up as the Lord comes to redeem God's people. It is a reminder for Christians in every age that faithful service will encounter evil. But Jesus is the Holy One of God, the true prophet. And he will set us free from anything that would diminish us as God's children. Listen to him. His authority was not demonstrated by political power or wealth or fame, but by his death and resurrection, love in action. As we confront the evils of our age, there will be unclean spirits as such that seek only harm rather than healing. The conspiracy theories rampant on social media about vaccines or about migrants, a culture obsessed with image rather than substance, a politics of false promises, or the underlying selfishness that reduces our capacity for everyone to flourish, we need to listen to Jesus. Perhaps the simplest test, when those who set themselves up as authorities want to claim our ears, our attention, not least of all as we move into a year of global elections as well as local, is to ask that those who claim authority, do their words heal or harm? Do they cause division or do they bring people together? The authority of Jesus was not used to line his pockets, get himself into a position of power, evade wrongdoing, or destroy his enemies. It healed a man. The world and the news, so often, how often do I find myself even saying this in the pulpit? Because I hear it from people saying that it feels so overwhelming. War, global poverty, climate change. What on earth can you do? As the preacher David Lowes points out, the world wasn't changed after that small act of healing in a tiny, backward village in a place nobody had really ever heard of. But the world was changed for that one man. And that one simple act of healing stands as a witness to an entire community. And that one simple act of healing became a witness to a community of believers who grew down through the centuries. You don't attempt to change everything. You just change what you can. And by God's grace, that can be a witness to others. So be encouraged today. Be encouraged that you are part of a fellowship listening to Jesus. The legacy of all those who have been faithful to Jesus in every year, recognizing his authority. Today, our Sunday club leaders are teaching our kids a Bible story about Jesus to gift them a vision of a world bigger than themselves. Others are praying for those ill or anxious and taking the time to phone or call with them. Others are giving what they can in the knowledge that God can use all that we have. Others are making friends and welcoming newcomers. Others are helping those in need because they are grateful for the generosity God has shown them. Others are slow to judge because experience has taught them the mercy of God. And you can't half tell there's a committee meeting this week with all the little other committee meetings taking place today. But there are those who have taken Christ's call upon their lives to serve. Let's be grateful too that for those in committee or session or any of our organizations who take the time out to to help our congregation flourish. And even those taking part in our service today, sharing in worship, calling each of us to listen to Jesus. All of us, recognizing the authority of Jesus in our lives, listening to him. Not much on our own, but by God's grace, we are all changing the world together. Amen. We worship God with our offering. A prayer of dedication. Let us pray. God of grace, in whose company we are made whole, we bless you for your generous love. Holy Spirit, may you teach us how to pray as we offer our thanksgiving, all that you have given us and who we are, in praise and service for your glory. And in Jesus' name, amen. In our prayers for others today, we invite you to use the words of the song, "Be still and know that I am God," to help us reflect on our prayers of intercession.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God.
Gracious God, as the disciples brought others to Jesus that he might lay his hands upon their lives and bless them, we offer our thoughts and prayers for people we bring to you now. And, like the disciples, we bring ourselves as well. We come to you, who is able to do so much more than we can imagine. We come to you, because already risen and ascended before the throne of God, pray for us, and for all whom we would bring to you. Receive our prayers, O Lord. Some are for people we love. Others are for people we find hard to love. Some are for people who are happy. Others are for people in pain. Some are for people we know. Others for people known by you. And in quiet moments, we pray.
I am the
Jesus, Savior. We pray today for a world so often in turmoil, caught up in fear or war, injustice, the neglect of the vulnerable and of creation. Teach us how best to use the freedom we have been given to serve you and to make cause with all who seek the well-being of others. We pray for people in positions of influence, remembering the internet and other forms of mass communication. May we have the wisdom to nurture what is good and guard against what is harmful. We pray for all who advance knowledge and extend the frontiers of science, thanking you for the many benefits we enjoy as a result. God only wise. May knowledge be used for good alone, and may we return often to the wellspring of wisdom that we may share what you have given us to drink with a thirsty world.
In you, O Lord God, I put my trust. In you, O Lord God, I put my trust. In you, O Lord God, I put my trust.
Savior Jesus, Son of God, we discover in you that already life has overcome death, goodness has triumphed over evil, forgiveness has won the victory over sin, love has conquered hate. In you, we renew our faith and commitment to your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Glory be to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and for always.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God.
Amen.
Of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful and will do this. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of you, now and always. And all God's people said, Amen.